So generally people do not get into chess because of money, but then it becomes very important once they fall in love with chess, because that's how you keep playing. So prize funds and women, what's your take on how important it is to have generous prize funds for women's competitions?
I mean, I think it's the biggest motivation. By the end of it, yes, you have to have a love for the game. You have to enjoy it, and you have to have fun while playing it. But end of the day, money talks, and everyone wants to see if the time that they've given and the childhood that they've devoted to the game and the hard work that they've put into it, what is it that they're going to get out of? Is it better to just have an academic career or maybe another sport or something else which pays better, or does chess really make it worth the while and you can actually get a living out of it? So prize fund, I think, Jen, is one of the biggest motivating factors for parents to understand that it's fine for them to invest in their child's career in chess because it does pay off, and for players to be more inspired because when you win, you want to win more, and prize money is a big incentive.
I agree. I mean, one of the reasons I love chess is that it actually provides a different value system outside of money. Like, the rating becomes kind of a proxy for how rich you are. I really like that about chess because I think, especially in the United States, we judge people so much by their net worth. But now it's like,
The
instead of
rating's not gonna buy you that dinner.
that's right, that's right. So, but the thing is, that chess players, I see them as artists, and to me, money is time. So if you love chess and you want to train and you want to get better and you want to win that national championship, you need that like kind of 6 months worth of living expenses and rent and food and travel and training
Yes.
expenses. And so if you get that big hit, you win 40K in the Cairns Cup, suddenly you have more time to devote to chess.
Absolutely. And it's I mean, a lot of people might feel that chess is not an expensive sport because the equipment itself is not that expensive. But actually, if you put things together with training and traveling, you do require a lot of funds to become a strong player. And I do feel that in most countries, there is a lot of financial support, but it more or less comes in when you've already made it. The real question is, how hard is it when you're, from being a good player to becoming one of the best players? That journey is a really tough one because the support is the financial support, and that's where it's missing. And I think there are countries that realize that, and there are countries that are working on that, whether it's China or Russia or US now, that how to make their good players the best players is by monetizing the career of chess.
I agree, and in the United States, we're doing better with it. I mean, we've got a lot of support via all sorts of different sources: U.S. Chess, Kasparov Chess Foundation, U.S. Chess School, the St. Louis Chess Club. But one really interesting story is the story of the 1959 U.S. Women's Chess Champion. Her name was Lisa Lane, and a lot of the women chess players at that time were quite wealthy. That's kind of how they afforded to play chess because there wasn't big prize funds at the time. Lisa Lane, from my very own Philadelphia, was not rich, and she was actually at some point passed over for selection for the women's Olympiad team, even though she was number two rated, because they said that they didn't think she would be able to afford it. So they invited a wealthier but lower-rated player. And, of course, now that would never happen, but it just goes to show you. And she actually organized protests about this $600 prize fund for the women's championship with first prize, with the overall championship getting a $6,000 prize fund. And, of course, some detractors would say, well, yes, the men have higher ratings. But the way I see it, and certainly the way that Lisa Lane saw it, is it's not just about how high rated you are. This is about time. It's about your
Yes,
time.
your investment.
You're promoting chess, you're playing, you're spending all these hours. Certainly Lisa Lane was interviewed more than any other player because she was also beautiful and said hilarious things. So she would talk about how she got love letters from so many chess players, and she said that she reads them and she files them, grandmasters on top. So she was a great interview. She's sitting there, okay, I get $600 for winning first place. This is messed up. She arranged a
I mean, it
protest.
really is. If you think about it, there are so many open events that happen, really strong open events in the world, and where, there are the women prizes are just, they're just there for the sake of it. I mean, you'll have €500 as the top women prize. I mean, it's better to not have it then than to have it at all, right? If you're going to have a women category prize, then you've got to make it something that actually is worth fighting for, where you've got the best players, the best women players in the world coming to that tournament to actually try to win it, which is why tournaments like the Isle of Man and the Gibraltar Masters, which has such a high prize fund, get the best elite women players of the world coming in and playing with the best male players in the world fighting for that top prize money.
That's right. In Gibraltar, it was £15,000 for first woman prize. And they're still eligible for the regular prizes.
And this is, yes, exactly. So that's really interesting because a woman player can actually win the open prize as well. So it's one of those, I think it's the only event where you're fighting for the top prize, which is so high, but you can also win the main prize. So it's a lot of positive discrimination for women there.
Yeah, but it's understandable in a way because this is what really makes the sport more popular. So if there's like big funding in chess, I think it does make some sense. I mean, I understand there's lots of men who work really hard and they're like, wow, I wish I was a woman so that I could earn these prizes. I think when men say that, they're not really thinking about all the different hurdles that you might have as a female.
That's true. And I think more times than not, they're just trying to be funny or joking about it, you know. But I think it's so important to have good prize money for women and to not take that away from tournaments.
No, I think it helps men in the end because the more women we have in the sport, the more legitimate the sport becomes, the more fun, the more attractive to sponsors. And I'm not going to mention his name, but there was actually a grandmaster who used to rail against these women's prizes. And then later he said...
There are a lot of them, Jen.
No, he railed really hard. And then like at some point he said he realized it was a ridiculous thing to rail against because there's so many people who get wealth in this country for bizarre reasons, you know, like... So many strange things that can happen that can make people rich. And here he was arguing against female chess players getting an extra $20,000. And soon after he let go of that, he became one of the best. So I think it's funny. Like if you have this negativity in your
head, it's
usually not going to serve you well. And I just honestly, Tania, I love to see chess players get more money, period.
Yes.
To me, it's like an art and they're the
female
people.
Female or male, yes.
Exactly. And so I think more women in the sport, though, is going to make the chess more popular. So Lisa Lane actually ended up quitting the game. And her protest was not immediately successful. She did not win out. She was on the cover of Sports Illustrated, so she became one of the most famous chess players in America. She was actually on the cover of Sports Illustrated before Bobby Fischer. And one of the only two chess players in its history on their cover. But she ended up quitting the game and going into other areas. But I still think we can look to Lisa Lane and her protests and say, right now we have $100,000 in the U.S. Chess Championship for women. And the open section is, of course, open to both genders. And women like Lisa kind of paved the way.
Absolutely. And talking about, prize fund, the FIDE World Championship has now been announced from 200,000 to 500,000. I mean, that's a huge record jump. And when female players and they see that, they're motivated to not just fight for that, to become stronger chess players overall.
Absolutely, yes. I was so thrilled. I mean, I'm so excited that this is happening, the new leadership in FIDE.
Yes.
And to me, there's so many things that you could have talked about. And I noticed that literally the first thing that Dvorkovic talked about was the women's chess. that's a really good sign that it's not on the back burner. That it's not like, oh yeah, the women's chess, that's something we'll talk about like in meeting number 10. It's like, no, right now.
No, yeah, they came into power in October. And I think in November, they just announced the new world championship cycle with all these changes. So you know that they've got women's chess as a priority. So they've got their priorities right.
Phenomenal. And of course, Zhu Wenjun did win that Women's World Championship while the announcement was being made, won $60,000. But she's phenomenal winning the World Championship twice in 1 year. I mean, God, shout out to her. But it'll be even better if we see bigger prize funds for people who accomplish things like that.
I think that's the future.